What is going on, everybody? Hey, it's me again, Mr. Marklevitz, bringing you today lesson 2.1 on hair, costumes, and makeup. But before we get there, we have to talk about what is Unit 2 even about? Well, Unit 2 is about this fancy French phrase called mise en scène. What am I talking about? Well, basically, when you're watching a film, everything that you see in the observable frame is part of the mise en scène. Whether that's the setting where the film takes place, the props that the characters use, the different lighting schemes and color palettes, the way that an actor moves throughout the set, or, which we're going to talk about today, the hair, costume, and makeup of a character. It all contributes to the film's mise-en-scene. So in this clip, we see the Joker, played by Jack Nicholson, in Tim Burton's Batman. Notice how his hair is perfect, his makeup is perfect, his costume is always nicely pressed. All of these elements tell us something about this character, okay? But this is a very stylized version of the Joker, okay? Whereas in Christopher Nolan's The Dark Knight from 2008, we see the same character played by Heath Ledger, but notice how the hair is longer and it's more unkempt. It's not even that green. His face paint looks like he just sort of woke up and slapped it on his face. The scars are a lot more prominent on the side of his face. His suit, still purple, but it's a little dirtier, right? This version of the Joker seems a little bit more realistic than the stylized version that we see in Tim Burton's version. So we have two different actors in two different films playing the same character, but notice how in each example, the hair, the costume, and the makeup tells the audience two very different ideas for how these characters are meant to be portrayed. We have the very realistic Joker in Christopher Nolan's version, and we have a very stylized version of the Joker in Tim Burton's version. You can also communicate character through hair, costume, and makeup. Let's take a look at this clip from My Fair Lady.
Lots of chocolate for me to eat. Lots of how might you lots of eat.
In the beginning of the film, we see Audrey Hepburn's character, Eliza Doolittle, on the street, and her clothing is very tattered. She's made up to look very dirty, her hair is a mess, and we can assume that this character is of a very low social standing. However, throughout the film, notice how her makeup changes, her hair changes, her clothing changes, and as a result of all these changes, we can assume that this character has moved out of the slums and is now of a higher social standing. We can also communicate a character's occupation, their attitude, their lifestyle choices, all through hair, costume, and makeup. Let's take a look at four examples from four different films involving teachers. So in this first example, we see Ryan Gosling from the film Half Nelson. He's wearing a short sleeve collared shirt. He has a tie that doesn't match the shirt and it doesn't quite go all the way up to the collar. His hair is sort of a mess. It looks like he hasn't shaved in days. He has some makeup under his eyes to make himself look a little tired or maybe a little under the influence. And all of these choices tell us something about the character, okay? Whereas in this example from Fast Times at Ridgemont High, we see Mr. Hand. Mr. Hand is in a suit. His hair looks very clean and very kept. His beard looks very trimmed. And all of these different choices tell us that this character demands respect. In this clip, we see Matthew Broderick from the film Election. He too has hair that is rather disheveled. He has some gray on the sideburns, which could indicate his middle age. He has this bug bite over his eye, so that means there must have been something horrific in his recent past. And all of these choices are telling us something about this character. And finally, we see Jack Black in School of Rock, and at least he's really trying to fit in, okay? He's got the suit. He's got the little bow tie, he's got the scarf, and all of these choices hit because this is a character who does not belong in the environment that he currently finds himself in. And he's trying really hard to fit in, but everything is just slightly off. And the design team, they did their job. They knew that, okay? These choices were made with that in mind. And that leads to my next point. None of these choices are left to chance. Everything that you see in regards to hair, costume, and makeup, these decisions are made months in advance. Nobody showed up to set that day and just said, hey, I'm good let's roll them. No, okay, all of these choices were made by the director, the screenwriter in some cases, and the design team in order to convey a very specific message to you, the audience. And if they did their job, then you got that message, whether consciously or unconsciously, you got it, all right? Your lab assignment for this week, I want you guys to choose three characters from any film and explain how their hair, costume, and makeup contributes to their character, okay? And I don't want you to pick three different characters from three different films. I want three different characters from the same film, because what I'm worried about is you'll go for the easy ones. You'll be like, Freddy Krueger, Jason, and Michael Myers. Well, what are you going to say about those three characters? Even though they look completely different, they're all basically the same, right? What's their makeup like? It's scary. What's their clothing like? It's kind of torn and tattered and dark. What's their hair like? Well, some of them don't have hair, and some of their hair is messy because, again, they're scary. And it's like, well, where are you going with that, okay? If you want to talk about Michael Myers, pick Halloween. You can still have Michael Myers as one of your characters, but instead of focusing on another monster or another villain for your second and third characters, talk about Jamie Lee Curtis's character. Why is her hair the way it is? Why is she not under a lot of makeup? Why is her clothing the way it is? And maybe for the third character, talk about the doctor or somebody like that. I also think it's very important to choose three different characters from the same film because the same design team created these three different characters, okay? I want you to see how the same people can basically create different characters using different elements, all right? And then finally this week, guys, we are going to watch The Elephant Man from David Lynch, which is a wonderful film to watch when discussing hair, costume, and makeup. Now, two things that I didn't talk about earlier in the lecture were how hair, costumes, and makeup can contribute to the time and place that your film is set. The Elephant Man happens to be set in London during the 19th century, and certainly the costume decisions and the hairstyles reflect that very specific time and place. Also, the makeup in this film is absolutely phenomenal. They used a lot of prosthetics to make up the titular character, John Merrick, and the film was essentially so good at creating this character that the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences had to create an entire new category for the Oscars in order to honor the contributions of makeup in film. So it's important to note that this film did not win an Academy Award for Best Makeup, but they felt compelled, or pressured, I guess, to create that category for the very next year, because this film was just such a phenomenal example of what you could do with makeup. So there you go, guys. If you have any questions, email me. Otherwise, I'll talk to you later.